Hello. When you think about visiting the St. Louis Art Museum, one thing that might come to mind is walls filled with paintings. The museum has all types of paintings, like portraits of people, pictures with lots of color, or scenes that tell a story. Today, we're going to talk about paintings of nature. Stopping to look closely at a painting allows us to see all kinds of details that the artist has included. And if we use our imaginations to step inside the painting, it can even transport us to another place. My name is Leslie, and I'm so happy that you're joining us on an art quest. Today, Lisa is going to tell us about artists who have painted scenes inspired by nature, and then Pratima will show us how to make paint so we can create our own nature scenes.
On today's art quest, we'll explore three paintings that were inspired by and feature scenes of nature. We'll learn some art words. We'll look closely at the details in these paintings, and we'll learn some drawing and painting techniques.
As always, we will end our quest with an art project. This involves painting a nature or an outdoor scene using paints made at home. Feel free to pause this video at any time to discuss the artwork with the people you're with or to gather materials or supplies for your art project. Are you ready? Let's go!
Lush green rolling hills border a light blue river that bends its way towards the pink and peach colored sky. The tall trees and a few boats on the still water add to this calm and serene landscape. This scene of the outdoors, titled Landscape, was painted by the artist Helen Matilda Kingman, who was just 15 years old when she created this work of art in 1845. This is the only known painting by this artist. The artist painted a lot of details, such as canoes and sailboats in the water, palm trees, tropical plants, and the reflections on the water. Kingman painted those objects closest to the viewer in brighter colors and those further away in paler or subdued colors to identify foreground, middle ground, and background in this artwork. Let's look closely at this landscape to learn more about foreground, middle ground, and background. The background is the part of the painting that is furthest away from us, the viewers. In this painting, the sky, some of the grayish-green hillsides, and the water where it meets the pink sky make up the background. Things in the background are usually smaller in size, duller or less bright in color, and are shown with less detail than the objects in closer parts of the painting. The middle ground is the part of the picture in between the foreground and the background. What can we find in the middle ground of this painting? Let's look. The canoe is in the middle ground. What else is in the middle ground? Most of the river, the green hillsides on either side of the river, the homes, and reflections in the water are all in the middle ground. Lastly, the foreground contains the objects that are closest to us, the viewers. An artist balances his sketchbook as he captures a scene filled with the red glow of dusk. What else can you find in the foreground? If you were given the chance to be a part of this painting, where would you choose to be? Would you be floating on a boat in the middle ground? Or perhaps high in a tree in the background? Or up on the hill in the foreground? What would you see from your location in the painting? Let's take a moment to look at this painting. Take a deep breath. As you inhale, think of a word or a feeling or an emotion that comes to mind when you look at this work of art. As you exhale or let go of the breath, imagine this word or feeling or emotion floating across the painting like a slow-moving cloud or a balloon. As we look closely at this landscape of spiky yellow, red, and green mountains, we notice some of the curved lines and shapes are two green goats who are partially hidden or camouflaged. Rounded forms of red, purple, blue, and green float in the upper right side of the canvas. Two long vertical bars of blue and orange cross the goat in the center. The artist Franz Marc was a member of Der Blau Reiter, or the Blue Reiter Expressionist Artist Group, and was well known for his paintings of animals. Expressionist artists often try to express a feeling or emotion with the art they create, using color, shape, line, and other elements to convey emotion. In expressionist art, animals and recognizable objects are often painted in bright, glowing colors that are different than in reality, such as a pink cat or a blue goat. Pick two of your favorite colors or shapes in this painting. How does each of them make you feel? Imagine you are sitting under this tree. Look up at the branches. What do you hear? What do you see? What do you smell? A large tree rises from the bottom of this canvas and fills the entire space. The artist, David Johnson, painted this cedar tree in great detail. Notice the peeling bark, the angular branches, the slender needle-like green leaves, light and shaded areas on the trunk, and the various knots on the tree. He painted the cedar tree from a perspective that makes it appear massive. Perspective is the angle or direction from which a person looks at an object. From what perspective is the artist viewing this tree? Where would he be standing in order to see the tree this way? Although the close-up view of the tree and the fact that it fills the entire canvas gives a sense that the painting is large. In fact, the painting is quite small. Study of a cedar is 20 by 14 inches, or about the size of two sheets of printer paper. To create this detailed and close-up image of the cedar tree, Johnson placed his easel outdoors, near the tree. He observed the details as he painted on the canvas. He did not paint from memory or from a photograph. Johnson's details include the perspective of the tree, light and shadow, the texture of the bark, the color and texture of the needle-like leaves, and other characteristics specific to the tree. Painting outside in nature meant facing the challenges of weather and required planning to make it successful. Here's an activity you can try later. To experience observing nature and making art outdoors as David Johnson did, take a sketchbook or a piece of paper and a pencil with you to your yard or the local park or a favorite outdoor place. Pick a favorite tree, shrub, plant, or anything from nature. Find a comfortable spot to sit close and observe, then draw what you see. Add as many details as you wish to your sketch. The three works of art we've explored together have some things in common. They all depict scenes of nature. All three were made using the same materials, which is oil paints on canvas. The different painting styles and techniques set them apart. Helen Kingman used foreground, middle ground, and background to create the idea of space and depth in her landscape. Franz Marc made use of lines, shapes, and bright colors to paint a nature scene, and David Johnson chose to do a detailed study and painting of a cedar tree. We invite you to visit slam.org to learn more about these and many other works of art in the museum's collection.
Now, let's use our observations from the three works of art we just explored to inspire our own nature painting. To get started, gather some supplies and let's learn how to make our own paints. I am going to make paint using food dye. If you do not have food dye, another way to make something that you can paint with is to recycle or reuse some old markers you have around the house. To do this, first remove the caps and add each color of the markers to a glass of water. I have about 3 ounces of water here in this glass. Let the markers soak in the water for about an hour or longer so that the water turns the color of the marker. I let my markers sit in this glass of water for over a day. Remove the markers and you have watercolors. I'm using this muffin pan to mix my paints. If you are using an egg carton made of cardboard, line the carton with foil to make sure the paints you mix do not leak through or get absorbed by the cardboard. If you have individual plastic or glass containers or trays to hold the paints, that would be just fine. You can use either baking soda or cornstarch to make your paints. I experimented making paint using both materials. I made red paint using baking soda and green paint using cornstarch. I noticed that as the red paint made with baking soda dried, it appeared powdery. The green paint made with cornstarch feels smoother when dry. For each color, add a tablespoon of either baking soda or cornstarch. I'm using cornstarch to make my paints today. Next, add 4 drops of food coloring and 1 to 2 tablespoons of water. Using a spoon, mix your paint ingredients until they are well combined. If using baking soda, you will notice that the paint has a grainy texture. Cornstarch, when mixed with water, thickens very quickly, so you might have to add a little extra water to make it easier to stir the solution. If the colors seem light, you can add more food dye to make the colors richer or more vibrant. I am making the 3 primary colors, red, yellow, and blue. Now that I've made my paints, I'm going to test them for consistency and color. These primary colors can be mixed to make 3 additional secondary colors. Yellow and blue make green. Red and yellow make orange. Red and blue make purple. You can make as many shades of a color as you wish. For example, if I want to make a deeper shade of purple, I will need to add more blue. If I want my green to be lighter, I can add more yellow or more water. Once you have the right consistency and color, you are ready to paint. Take a piece of watercolor paper or construction paper or any thick non-gloss paper such as cardstock to make a sketch for your painting. If the paper is glossy, the paint will not be absorbed and will run. If you only have printer paper at home, that's fine. If using printer paper, lay two sheets on top of each other and tape or glue the edges together to make a thicker surface. I am making a sketch of a scene from a park I like to visit. I start out by drawing a line which separates the sky or the clouds from the land. This helps me decide where the sky ends and where the land begins in my painting. This is also known as the horizon line. Now, I am going to draw the puffy clouds in the sky, some big and some small. Then, I add an outline of trees in my background. Now, I'm adding the water in the middle ground. Finally, I'm adding these fallen tree trunks in my foreground. Just like David Johnson's use of perspective in Study of a Cedar, I am sketching the fallen trunks from the angle I see the scene. Before you paint, it might be helpful to sketch or lightly draw the main areas or the features of your nature scene, like a skyline or an outline of a tree or rolling hills. Don't worry about including the smaller details. Here's my completed sketch of the scene. Now I'm ready to paint. You may want to paint on a washable surface or cover your work surface with paper or plastic before you begin painting. I'm excited to paint this nature scene with my homemade paints. Make sure to have a container of water and a rag or a paper towel handy to rinse the brush as you go back and forth between different colors to paint your outdoor scene. What can you do if you don't have a paintbrush? Here are some options I found in my home. You can use Q-tips or a piece of sponge or a cotton ball as a brush. Dip your brush in the water and then dip it in the paint. Swirl the brush around to gather some paint on the brush. If the paint seems too thick, add some extra water to get the right consistency. If the paint is too runny, no worries. Just add more baking soda or cornstarch to make it thicker, or dab your brush on the rag or paper towel to absorb the extra liquid. As you can see, I started out by painting the clouds and the sky. Rinse the brush in plain water and pat it dry on a rag or a paper towel before you dip the brush in a different color to keep the colors from mixing. I've painted the blue sky and now I'm moving on to paint the trees in the background. Now I'm painting the water body, which is in the middle ground. I find it easier to paint things in the background first and paint the foreground last. This helps the areas I already painted to dry, and I'm less likely to smear any parts of my painting or get my hands messy. Finally, I'm painting the fallen tree trunks in the foreground. Similar to how Helen Kingman painted her landscape, I'm using duller colors in the background and brighter colors in the foreground to make the brighter colored shapes appear closer to the viewer. I'm adding a second coat of paint to some of the areas of my painting to make it more vibrant. I'm adding just a few details around the clouds. Here are two different ways to make a nature painting. This one is a landscape painted by using foreground, middle ground, and background elements. And this one is a nature scene painted in an expressionist style. The painting is based on close-up details of a butterfly wing and a flower. We would love to see what you make. Please share your creations on social media by using the hashtags STLArtMuseum and SlamArtQuest. Thank you for joining us today. Keep exploring and making art, and we hope you will visit the museum soon.